I went ahead and drew up this diagram to explain to you why DSL services may fail, but the phone operating on the same line is okay. Now this diagram has this phone switch, which the telephone service is coming from, connected to a high-speed card, and also the internet service is also connected to the same high-speed card. Now both of these signals are multiplexed together and sent out across a copper twisted pair line. I know this doesn't look like twisted pair, I just drew it like this for simplicity. It represents the twisted pair above here, okay? Now this is connected to a pot splitter. Now the pot splitter separates both your voice and your data, and it sends the voice to the phone and the data to the modem. Now, as we said before, the problem here is that we're trying to figure out why the phone is working but the internet is not working at this stage. Assuming that the modem is okay, the pot splitter is okay, and there are no metallic problems on the line or problems with the high-speed card. So assuming everything is fine with the line, your phone is working fine but your internet is not, and you're trying to figure this out. Now, taking one step back and taking a look at this, one thing I can see that jumps out at me right away is that the phone, which operates at a frequency between 300 Hz and 3500 kHz. Now the internet is operating at 12 MHz for this particular line. The phone sends its signal out onto the line. This line looks like a capacitor to the high-speed card. You may be wondering at this point, a capacitor? Why would a line look like a capacitor? Line is just two wires. Well, that's exactly what it is. Two wires, and two wires in parallel like this, with power connected to it, would act just like a capacitor. Remember, that's exactly what a capacitor is. Two plates with power connected on both sides. And what happens is that if you have an alternating current, capacitor charges, and when that alternating current changes polarity, that capacitor discharges. The same thing here. When this signal here is applied to the line, this line charges. Like, for instance, this side here may charge positive, this side may be negative. And then when the alternating current changes, this will discharge, just like a capacitor, and discharge into the phone. And when polarity changes, it will charge in opposite directions. And then when polarity changes again, it would discharge towards the phone as well. So this would just continue forever. And this is how the phone is currently working, and this is how it is supposed to work, and everything is fine with the phone. But however, the modem is not working. So the line is not performing in the way it is supposed to in order to get the signal through to the modem. For the modem, you have 12 megahertz. And this signal of 12 megahertz go through the line in the same way. But instead of charging the plates up and then discharging when polarity changes, like the phone did, what is happening is that the signal is going right through from one plate to the other. As I said, this looks like a capacitor, so it's going right through from one plate to the other, or from the tip of the line to the ring of the line. And then that signal is lost forever. The reason for this is because when the frequency increases, the resistance between the two plates decreases, especially when you have a line of this length. And the longer the line, also the lower the resistance between the plates. The higher the frequency or the longer the line, the lower the resistance is between the plates. So then your signal goes right through from one plate to another and be lost, instead of charging the plate, and then when polarity changes, it is discharged into the modem. So here I have a formula here just to show you that this actually works. I know some of us don't like formulas, and I don't love formulas either, but just bear with me, this formula will help you really solve any problems that you may have in trying to figure out how DSL line frequencies and distance work. Now XC equals 1 over 2 pi FC, and the results are in ohms. Now XC equals 1 over 2 times 3.14. 3.14 is the pi signal times, And I went ahead and made the frequency just a number 2, just for simplicity, just to show you exactly how this worked. And the capacitance, I also gave it a number of 2. And then the total amount is 0.39 ohms, okay? So I went down here and did the same thing, but all I changed in the second equation was the 4. The frequency, I changed from 2 to 4. The distance, which is the capacitance, remained at 2. So by doing that, my resistance dropped from 0.039 to 0.019. So as you can see here, by increasing the frequency, I dropped the resistance. The resistance decreased between plates. So increasing frequency would cause even more current to flow between these two plates. So the more current flows between these two plates for a particular frequency, that means that that current is not getting out to the modem. So your modem is going to be out of service because it's not getting the current that it requires to keep on working. So distance and frequency is very important for DSL line. I just show you that here. So if we should shorten this line to 500 meters, this line would be up and running because now we have changed the capacitance. We have shortened the capacitance, so we have less capacitance, so we have more resistance between these two plates here. So now we'll have this plate charging, and when the polarity changes, it discharges into the modem. So you'll be getting a signal now going through the modem instead of that signal being lost between the plates of the capacitor or between the lines, which are called tip and ring. If this video has been helpful to you and you'd like to see more videos like this one, please don't forget to click on the subscribe button so that you'll be alerted as soon as our new videos are released. My name is Trevor from Telecom Training. Thank you for watching.